thanks to this music. What's up, family? What's up, family? It's my third time coming to you today. This probably my last time coming today. I wanted to get on record. The book, The Slave Code, in Theory and in Practice, by William Goodale. Again, The American Slave Code, in Theory and in Practice. I want to stay consistent with this book. I want to stay consistent so you know the actual laws that are written on the books to this day. These laws are, this is like a legal book right here. These laws are literally on the book to this day and can be reinforced, can be enforced. And actually, they are being enforced, unbeknownst to you and to many. Again, I challenge you. I challenge every one of you, black, white, Asian, Latino, Russian, Italian, to get the book. Just get the American Slave Code in theory and in practice. Get the book because I think that we suffer in America from a lack of understanding. We've been miseducated. Our white brothers have been miseducated. The blacks have been miseducated. The Asians. People don't know the history of this country. They don't know the laws that's on the books of this country. And me being 20 years law enforcement, I have a very idea. I know the law. And I enforce the laws. But those that are coming to America, they don't know the law. They don't know the law. So it's my duty to bring to your attention, if no more just to read the laws that's on the books, just read it for yourself. Read what others had said in the 1700s, in the 1800s. Read the precedents, the statutes, the amendments, the legislations, how they enforce these laws. That's important. Again, we are functioning out here not knowing that these laws are still on the book. So it is my responsibility, my duty, to just read the laws to you. I'm just going to read it. And then you get the book, The American Slave Code, in Practice and in Theory. You said, why is that relevant now? Because a lot of stuff that we do right now is instinctively, it's automatically, because the code has been passed down from generation to generation in our DNA. Not just our DNA, but in our white brothers' DNA. And the things they do and the things we do is instinctive. It's like a silent code. It's like when white folks come around, or one, it could be a group of us all talking. It takes one white person to come around and then we start whispering. That's part of the code. That's a code. You inherited that. You inherited that. It's in your DNA. So again, I'm just going to read some of the code, and I'm going to come back and read some of the code this week and read it until I finish this whole book. Now, the chapter I'm going to start on is chapter 6, but I'm going to bypass the first 5 chapters. But I'm going to go to the table of contents and read the first 5 chapters that I'm going to not read, start with. But I'm going to start with the sixth chapter. But the chapters I'm not going to read is this. The first chapter is slave ownership. The second chapter will be slave traffic. The third chapter is seizure of slave property for debt. The fifth chapter is inheritance of slave property. The sixth chapter is the use of slave property. And the seventh chapter, slaves can possess nothing. Let me say this again. Slaves. When I say slaves, think about my ancestors, your ancestors, our great-great-great-great-grandparents before they passed it, before they emancipated us. We could own nothing. So I'm going to start with the seventh chapter, which is slaves can possess nothing. I may go with the eighth chapter next sometime this week and say slaves cannot marry. Because you realize this, look, this, the Supreme Court came into existence, what, 1789, 1729? They've only been around 200 some years, but they've been around long enough to enforce these codes, to make sure the codes was enforced. That's why all y'all who keep saying that the Supreme Court is the moral authority of the land, I think not. I've got the code that disputes that. I should have been a lawyer. I should have. So again, chapter seven. Slaves can possess nothing. I'm just going to read. Like I said, I'm reading to leave a body of information for the children's children years from now. Whoever gets this years from now, they'll see that there's a body of information that's been left on record that you'll see that it was not brought to your attention in school, whether it was grade school, middle school, high school, and maybe even in college. They don't talk about this. I'm just going to read. A first-hand account, statutes, amendments, legislation. I'm just going to read that, okay? Again, get the book. The American Slave Code, in Practice and in Theory, by William Goodale. The American Slave Code, in Practice and in Theory, by William Goodale. Again, The American Slave Code, in Practice and in Theory, by William Goodale. Let me read. Slaves cannot possess nothing. Being property themselves, they can own no property nor make any contract. Man was created proprietor of the earth with dominion over the beasts of the field. And I'm going to say the fowl of the air and the creepers too. That's the scriptures. But the first thing that this book says, man was created proprietor of the earth with dominion over the beasts of the field. That is true. The humanity of the slaves is denied by denying to him any share in this original right of human nature or capability of its exercise. Let me say this again. The humanity of the slave, the humanity of our ancestors, is denied by denying him any share in this original right of human nature or capability of its exercise. You wonder why we have a hard time being creative, owning things, because it has been driven in us that we can own nothing, we can have nothing, that we don't even have dominion. He is not ranked among other beings, but among things. He is not ranked among beings, but among things. A chattel cannot be the owner of chattel. Hear that again. A chattel cannot be the owner of chattel. The slave can possess nothing, nor can acquire anything, but what must belong to his master. The American Slave Code, in Practice and in Theory. Get the book. I'm just reading the chapters. Just reading it. I'm gonna read that again. A chattel cannot be the owner of chattel. Because it was good. As I said, we were and still are considered chattel slavery. We are the children of chattel slavery. We are the descendant of slaves. When you see the acronym DOS, that means descendant of slaves. But we also the children of chattel slavery. Okay? And I'm reading where it says slaves can possess nothing. We couldn't possess nothing, okay? And that's in Civil Code Art 35. That's in the book, the Civil Code Art Article 35. They cannot take, buy, purchase anything. Slaves have no legal rights in things real or personal. But whatever they may acquire belongs in point of law to their masters. That's in Stroud, page 25 and 45. Again, slaves have no legal rights in things real or personal. But whatever they acquire belongs in point of law to their masters. So whatever our ancestors acquired back in the 16, 17, 18, hundreds, 14, 15s, it belonged to the masters. You own nothing. Slaves can make no contract. Slaves are incapable of inheriting or transmitting property. That's in the Civil Code, Article 945. By the Roman law, the slave might possess what was called his pendulum, or what was his master's right. That was in the Romans' law, the Roman time of the Romans. Okay, by stipulation, accord to him, in which having this stipulated, he could not afterwards take from him. By this law, slaves acquired property, sometimes embarked in commerce, redeemed themselves, and amassed fortunes. They're talking about under the Roman system, not under the colonial system. The colonial system is different than the Roman system. That's why I tell folks about colonial Christianity or the colonial mindset was far different than the Romans. Okay? Let me keep going. Without an absolute purchase of themselves, paid their masters an annuity as the price of their services and attended to their own affairs. Not so in Republican and Christian America. So the author was making the distinction between Roman times and what's going on in the Republic of America, Christian times. Let me go back and read this again. By Roman law, in the times of the Romans, the times of the Messiah, the times of the Jesus period, okay, the slaves might possess what was called his peculium, or what his master might by stipulation accord to him, and which having this stipulated, he could not afterwards take from him. But by this law, slaves acquired property sometimes from the Roman period, sometimes embarked in commerce. They was able to redeem themselves and amass fortunes. Or in other cases, without an absolute purchase of themselves, paid their masters an annuity as the price of their services and attended to their own affairs. But not so in a Republican in Christian America. Remember, America is a republic. It's a republic. Okay? This legal relationship, or better yet, this legal relation here is another thing. The only exception approximating the Roman Code in this particular, so far as we know, is found in the Civil Code of Louisiana as follows. All that a slave possesses belongs to his master. He possesses nothing of his own. Okay? He possesses nothing of his own. That is to say, the sum of money, a movable estate, which his master chooses, he doesn't possess. He possesses nothing. That's in the article 175 in the First Martin's Digest, page 616. Article 175, 1 Martin's Digest, 616. It gives you the references in the pages and the articles and the books you can read to do the follow-up if you really want to follow the codes. Yet in the same code stands the following. Slaves cannot dispose of or receive by donation, okay, unless they have been previously and expressly enfranchised, okay, to the law, or unless they are expressly enfranchised by the act by which the donation is made to them. That's Article 1462. Okay? The earnings of a slave and the price of their service belong to their owners. The earnings of a slave and the price of their service belong to the masters, the owners, the white folks, okay? Who have their action to recover the amount of those who have employed them. That's in Louisiana Code of Practice, Article 103. Except in the permission of the laws of other states on this subject and are similar to those in Louisiana. In South Carolina, it states, slaves cannot take by descent or purchase. Okay, that's going to be in Chancery's Report 266, Bynum versus Boswick. North Carolina, slaves cannot take by sale or devise or descent a devise of land to be rented out for the maintenance of a slave which adjudged to be void. Slaves cannot take by sale or descent a piece of land to be rented out for the maintenance of a slave or was adjudged to be void. That's in First Cambrian and Norwood Reports 353. Same decisions, First Taylor Reports 202. This is a law book. So folks who are whose attorneys and judges, what I'm reading, they can look up to the Black's Law Book and put up these codes and reports. To the average layperson, it may not make no sense to you. But just get beyond the reports and just listen to the words. These are actual firsthand accounts in the American Slave Code, in practice and in theory, okay? Maryland. A gift, bequest, or devise made to a slave by anyone not his owner will be void. That's going to be in Dooley's Opinion 1, Maryland Reports 561, as if you're a lawyer or a judge. Though such a device of real or personal estate made by the owner of a slave has been held to entitle him to freedom as the implied intention of the owner. Hill versus Mullins, Harris and Johnson Report 190. In Wheeler's Law of Slavery may be found ample evidence that this feature of the slave code is not a dead letter, but recognized by the courts and enforced whenever there is occasion, not only to the letter of the statute, but by an application of the principle and the spirit of the enactment in the contingency which legislative did not foresee. Basically, a slave, for instance, accidentally found a sum of money in a bank bills, which someone took from him and carried to the bank. The owner of the slave boy brought an action of trover against the bank for the sum and recovered it by the judgment of the court. So a slave found some money, got a hold of a wad of money, and couldn't even keep it. A boy. Okay? The owner of the slave boy brought an action of the trover against the bank for the sum and recovered it, and the judge gave him the money. So a slave found some money. You know who it belonged to? He couldn't even keep it. Our slaves can do nothing in their own right, can hold no property, can neither buy, sell, barter, nor dispose of anything without permission from the master or overseer. And that's why I don't deal with that term in these churches when they keep using that term, overseer. You're invoking a colonial spirit in our churches, and you're wondering why our people are acting like slaves, because you got these terms like overseer. I'm going to leave that right there. I ain't here to preach. I'm just going to read. Without express permission from the master or the overseer, so that everything they can possess or do is in legal authority of the master. Again, our slaves can do nothing in their own right, can hold no property, can neither buy, sell, barter, dispose of anything without express permission from the master or the overseer. Get the book. People say, why do you keep going back there? We're not there no more. We are there. We're still there. The code is now written on our hearts. People are acting like white people, black people are responding to different codes. Whites have a code they respond to, and they stay on code. And blacks have a code they respond to. And what's the code? Our white brother believes, you know what? He's super. He's the master. And blacks still have this, I'm a servant mentality. You ask your average, just ask your group of white friends, not one, a group of them, and just ask just one question. Just one question. Are we all equal? And just wait for a response. Is all things equal between the oppressor and the oppressed? Is all things equal between the children of chattel slavery, the descendants of slaves, and the descendants of the masters? That's a question. You don't have to answer the question, because look at how we respond to things in our world, in our society, in our communities. Look how we respond to the killings and how they respond to the killings. Look at the news. You know, you would think that Asians don't have no murders and the Latinos don't have no murders in their community, because all you see is black on black crime. You would think the white folks don't have no crime. The only news we normally get is black crime. You mean tell me America has maybe 340 million people and there is no Asian crime in the Asian? There's no Asian crime at all? We don't hear nothing about Asians killing Asians? No Latinos killing Latinos? No Jews killing Jews. Let me not digress. Let me stay on my topic. A slave is in absolute bondage. Let me say this again. A slave is in absolute bondage. He has no civil right and can hold no property except at the will and pleasure of his master. And his master could have been a young child or an old woman, but all masters was white. That's the code. That's a code. A slave is a rational being and endowed with understanding and volition, like the rest of mankind. And whatever he lawfully acquires and gains possession of by finding or otherwise, it is the acquirement and possession of the master. Whatever he found, whatever he came in contact with, it belonged to the master. And these codes are on the book today. Today. Can I read it again? A slave is a rational being and endowed with understanding like the rest of mankind. And whatever he lawfully acquires and gains possession of by finding or otherwise is the acquirement and possession of the master. Okay? A slave cannot take property by descent or purchase. Branham, Merchants and Planters, Bank of Huntsville, Stewart's, Alabama, reports, page 320, S&P Bynum versus Bostick, 4, Desaurius, 266, Wheeler's Law of Slavery, page 6 and 7. These are all amendments. These are all codes on the book to this day. Okay? In the preceding decision, the manhood, the reason, the understanding of the slaves are distinctively recognized. And for the express purpose of claiming all the acquirements of such a being as the property of his master, equivalent to the claim of absolute proprietorship. We're talking about absolute proprietorship in the human soul itself. Good God, I feel that. In the human soul, the theory and the practice of slavery are here found to be in harmony, and the courts enforce the enactments of the legislation. And this is why I said this about the Supreme Court, about the federal court, about the district courts, about all of them. And I enforce the law. I mean, you're not talking to somebody who doesn't know the law. I enforced the law for 27 years. May not be a lawyer, but I was a police officer. Come on. I know what the hell I'm talking about. I know what I'm reading. These statutes, these amendments, these codes are on the book right now and can be enforced. Okay, the theory and the practice of slavery are found to be in harmony, and the courts enforce the enactments of the legislature. In a note to the preceding decision, Mr. Wheeler says on page 7, these principles prevail in all the states and are taken from the civil law, and were adopted in all except Connecticut and perhaps Massachusetts. Let me say this again. In a note to the preceding decision, Mr. Wheeler says on page 7, these principles prevail in all the states and are taken from the civil law and were adopted in all except Connecticut and perhaps Massachusetts. Hall versus Mullen, number 5, and Johns, Maryland Report, page 190. We're talking about slaves can own nothing. We're talking about this is less than 200 years ago. Okay? I'm just going to keep reading. The court held that no legal contract whatever could be made with a slave. Let me say this again. The court held that no legal contract whatever could be made with a slave without the consent of his master. and Jackson, the People versus Lurvy, Five Coins, Representative 397, the court held that a slave at common law could not contract matrimony, nor could the child of a slave take by descent or inheritance. Read it again. The court held that a slave at common law. Now, you know what common law is? Common law is people living together, not even going before a judge. Common law could not contract matrimony. They could not be even given a matrimony, nor the child of a slave take by descent or inheritance. Okay? Free Lucy and Frank, fall terms, 1826 for Monroe's Representative 167. These are just case laws. Emerson versus Harlan, number one, Mason's Report, 45. The court held that contracts made by Negroes while in slavery do not bind them when liberated. Say it again. The court held that contracts made by the ancestors, because I want to bring it home, while in slavery, do not bind them when they're liberated. And consequently, a plea from a free Negro that a writing used on was delivered when he was a slave is good. Okay? In a note on this topic, Mr. Wheeler says, one general principle prevails in all states and in the British, Spanish, Portuguese, West Indies, and that is that a slave cannot make a contract, not even the contract of matrimony. And he cites numerous authorities for the statement. Let me say this. Now, I'm just dealing with the colonial era right now. Okay? But he even expanded it and said the British Isles, the Spaniards, the Portuguese, the Portugals, who actually was the Portuguese and Spanish started this whole slave piece. And the Brits and the colonials, they refined it. They made it what it is today. I mean, they refined it, okay? But from the Brits, the Spanish, Portuguese, West Indies, and that is that a slave cannot make a contract, not even the contract of matrimony. They was all on the same page when it came down to slaves. You couldn't own nothing, and you couldn't even marry. Not even a common law marriage. Family, get the book, The American Slave Code, and Practice It in Theory. Get the book. I'm just reading. I don't know no more than you. As I read this, I'm learning too. But I know this needs to be read, and it needs to be passed down to our children's children. No longer can we just try to shield our children from the truth. White truth, black truth, Asian truth, it doesn't make a difference. You know, as long as we're going to remain depreciated, marginalized, devalued, underestimated, we're going to keep being all this until we let people know what we've had to deal with and what's on a book. Okay, let me keep reading. The slave is thus taught that his promises and agreements are of no binding force. Even the free Negro, as has been seen, is taught the same lesson in respect to his former condition. Yet those by whom these lessons are taught affect to marvel at the moral obscenity of the Negroes and consider themselves as occupying a high moral eminence above them. Okay? Should I read that again? No, let me keep on. A warrant for 1,000 acres of land issued to a slave in Tennessee for military services as a musician during the Revolutionary War was adjudged to be the property of his owner in 1834. The Supreme Court was in existence then. The moral Supreme Court that we call so moral, they adjudicated this property dispute, okay, of 1,000 acres, okay, in 1834. This decision was made against the claims of an heir of his former owner, Colonel Patton, a Revolutionary officer who caused his slave to be enlisted. No claim appears to have been set up on behalf of slaves. It says, see Wheeler's Law of Slavery, page 229. Though a slave can make no contract on his own account, yet his master may constitute a slave his agent for the most important transactions. So it's apparent that, well, I'm going to keep reading. We once know of a prominent public man whose personal credit in his market town was so low that his written order on his merchant for $50 worth of goods was rejected. But when his managing slave stepped forward and promised that the next load of produce should be delivered in payment, the answer was, very well, Kofi. If you say so, I'll deliver 10 times the amount of goods. I may have to read that again. Well, here it is. Let's deal with that military piece. You had military officers who allowed for their slaves to sign off on their property in case something happened to them. And it's apparently someone was dying and their slaves was like the power of attorneys over their properties. And it was not respected. It was not acknowledged. That's what it's saying. The decision was made against the claims of an heir of his former owner, Colonel Patton, a Revolutionary officer who caused his slave to be enlisted. No claims appear to have been set up on behalf of the slave. Well, I'll just keep reading. Okay. Chasten versus Bowman. May term, 1833. Number one, Hills, South Carolina reports, 276. The courts charged the jury that a slave might be the agent of his master. And if his agency was established, the master was bound. Verdict for the plaintiff in the motion for a new trial. Per cur, Johnson J. It is not questioned that a master may constitute his slave, his agent, and I cannot conceive of any distinction between the circumstances which constitute a slave and a free man agent. They are both the creatures of the principal and an act upon his authority. There is no condition, however degraded, which deprives one of the right to act as a private agent. The motion was dismissed. Wheeler's Law of Slavery, page 228. Okay? Again, just trying to bring reality to a society that's built on illusions. Illusions of we're all on the same page. Illusions of inclusion. Yes, we coexisting, but all things are not even in how they police in the inner city and how they police uptown. Okay, and how the laws are distributed with the wealthy and how laws are distributed with the poor. And I'm just reading. I'm not even going to explanation mode. I'm just trying to read because I just want, you know, sometimes you just got to read, you know. But get the book, The American Slave Code and Practice It in Theory. This is chapter 7, Slaves Can Own Nothing. Let me keep going. It is certainly remarkable that a man should have a right to act as an agent for another who can have no right to act for himself. Equally remarkable is the plea that slaves cannot take care of themselves and must be benevolently superintended for their benefit while they conduct the business of their masters. The slave is adjudged to be a mere thing, except where his master's interests or convenience require that he should be regarded a man. Another curiosity of slave jurisprudence deserves notice here. Although it is the adjudged an offense against the state for a free white person to hold honest commerce with a slave for the beneficial and useful purpose of life, to employ a slave to labor and to pay him just wages, an offense likewise for the master of a slave to permit authority such as transactions. It is not an offense either at common law or by statute to gamble with slaves. This statement is his marginal title to the law case. This statement, the State versus Pemberton and Smith, December terms 1829, North Carolina Rep 281, in which after the verdict for the state in his honor, Judge Strange arrested the judgment being an option as before stated. From this judgment, the solicitor for the state appealed, but the judgment of the court below was affirmed. It's just saying that even when the masters are trying to conduct their business and give their business to the most trusted slaves, they was not even acknowledged. Slaves could own nothing. They made no exceptions, no matter who you were, no matter what your profession, no matter what agreement you thought you had with your slave, the slave could not possess nothing. That's basically what it's saying. Nothing. Okay? I think I'm going to stop right there. Because I can read this all night. Well, I can't read it all night because I can't read it all night. But I think I'm going to stop right there. And I'm going to come back. I'm going to bookmark this. This is page 80. Page 80 I'm on. I'm going to pick up on page 81. Now, look. If you guys are serious about me reading this and you really want to read with me along, and I'll bring you on the split screen and we can discuss this, because I think that this book needs to be discussed, because it talks about our good born again Christian white brother who upheld laws that not even the disciples would agree with, not even Jesus would agree with, not even the Romans would agree with. Okay. And that's why, after I finish reading this book, I'm going to come back with this bomb of a book right here, David Walker's Appeal. Oh, my God. David Walker didn't spare our good, born-again, Christian white brother who enforced Jim Crow segregation. Okay? Slavery. Get the book. David Walker's Appeal. Required reading if you're black and white, Asian, Latino. Okay? I'm going to stop at page 80. I'm going to pick up at 81. I'm willing to do this maybe 2 or 3 times a week just to get through the whole book. If I can establish a time, I know you guys going to be here and you're going to listen and have your sons and your daughters and all, and just let me read to them and try to break this thing down. I even got some lawyer friends I will bring on, and we can break this book down. It's just that serious. I will not repeat on my watch, allow my children's children to go back under these circumstances of this illusion of inclusion, of this integration piece. Now, we integrate. I'm dealing with them right now. But I know these laws are on the book still. And if you get enough power, I get enough muscle, and you can produce the right amount of fear, you can enforce these laws again. Let me say something. Let me be very clear about something. The laws are only as good as the laws of a country are only as good as they can be enforced. Let me say this again. You can have all the laws you want. If you can't enforce some laws, it means nothing. As a law enforcement officer, I understand that obey the laws of the land is only as good as you're able to enforce the laws. Under the slave code, the only reason why the slave code stayed into existence for as long as it did, because they was able to enforce it. If you can't enforce the laws won't be enforced. And trust me, there's a group of people in the shadows that you do not see would love to bring things back to the way they used to be. I'm going to say this again. There's a group of people in the shadows that you do not see would love to bring things back to the 18s, 17s, 16, 1500s. And while we partying and shaking our asses, and while we drinking and we popping bottles, we fly, we making the pressure looks good, we blinging. But you better realize this, in the bigger scheme of things, from Maine to California is a crime scene. From Maine, the tip of Maine, Rhode Island, to California has been a crime scene for going on 400 years. And as a person who knows about crime scenes, you may want to ignore the crime scene, but the tape is still up and this body is laid out everywhere. And detectives like myself are on the scene. And I'm gathering evidence and I'm connecting the dots. Because we're going to trial. It's going to be a trial. You know, I teach the laws of arrest, search and seizure. I teach probable cause. Probable cause is a set of facts, circumstances, reliable information that would lead an officer to know that a person has committed, is committing, or have committed a crime. Probable cause. The foundation of policing rests on probable cause. If you don't have probable cause, you don't have nothing. You don't have an arrest. You don't have a trial. And you don't have a conviction. So where am I going with this? This book right here, The American Slave Code, and practiced in theory, is filled with probable cause. We have video of the rapes, the lynchings, the castrations, the murders, probable cause. We have the amendments now. That was on the book. We have the amendments. We have the statutes. All we need now is to put the pieces together. And share it with our children's children. And address the issue and stop running from the issue. We're in the era of Trump. Right? I've never seen in my 50 years on this world, in my, I guess, in my 30 years of cognitive and conscious, I've never seen nothing like this. Where white folks now have given black people a pass to speak their mind about one man in the system. And now they telling all their secrets now. I mean, I've never seen on this before. So while y'all are just being so mad and being pulled by feminism and angry white folks and other angry white folks, you need to be doing research on what we need to do before you find ourselves back in a situation like this. Okay? I want you to share this. Share this video. Share it with your friends, with your family. Go back and get your sons, your daughters, and just play it, replay it. I will be reading this. If I got to come twice or three times a week and just read it and we go through it together, I'll do it because I think it's just that important. This thing right there is spiritual. The laws are written on our hearts now. We just do things instinctively now. They do things instinctively. And these people from outside coming in, they don't know the history. So they marginalize us, devalue us, call us all these crazy names without knowing that our ancestors are crying from the grave, not to forget what happened to us. And I know it's painful. I know it's painful. I know you don't want to remember it. That's just, and that can never happen. You can't, and that can never happen. It's like telling a rape victim, just get over it. No, get a conviction first. Don't forgive until you get a conviction. Go to trial. Get a conviction. And then you can forgive all you want. But this is not the time to forget. This is the time to remember. Like I said, never forget is not a suggestion. It's a command. Never forget. Okay? So again, if you want to support me, we are going to build this media facility. So help me, God. You can go to GoFundMe.com/real-talk-media-facility. I even got a Cash App. Just got it last week. That you can go to. The Cash Sign. I got to always say, not Creflo Dollar, but it's the Cash Sign. My first name, J-U-A-N. Last initial, J-29. I am going to build a facility that promotes black thought, black voices. I'm not talking about corporate sport, not corporate owned, like Radio One. I'm talking about black voices, black thoughts, black opinions. I am unapologetic about what we need. And I'm not looking at what the others are doing. I'm looking at what we need to do. And we need to have our own media. Facts. So help me build a facility where we can share our voices, our thoughts, our concerns, our issues. It's just that serious. Again, Dick Gregory's birthday was 2 days ago. You heard nothing about it, and you're not going to hear nothing. Fannie Lou Hamer, you don't hear about these birthdays because these days are not important to them, to the dominant society, or to Asians. It's not important to them, but to us, it should be. It should be important to us. What's important to you? Is just partying important? Just living my best life? Is that important to you? Is that all you want to do, is live your own best life? What about your children? Children's children? Do you want to leave them in the same situation that was given to us? I don't. I won't. And I'm going to build this. So help me, God. God and me. Again, I'm going to come back here. It depends on how many responses I get from you guys. If you want me to come back and do this 3 days out the week. Just read it and go through it. If you do that, I will commit myself to it. If not, I'm going to still commit myself to it because I know this is just that important. Again, I want to thank you for tuning in. You could be elsewhere. I want to caution you. To be mindful of what you say and what you're doing these days. Be mindful of the words you use out your mouth. If you feel the unction or the urge to say something negative or curse somebody, don't do it. This season right now is a, if you think it, it'll happen. I'll give you a prime example. I just got my hair. Oh, I shouldn't talk about that. I'll do it. I thought about getting my hair done. The person done my hair last 8 years. I just thought about it. I said, I need to get my hair done. I called her. Then I didn't even know that she was off a couple days. And I saw everything I needed done. And within 1 day, it was done. Just my thoughts. So be mindful of what you're thinking. Be mindful of what you're saying. The ancestors are paying attention. And things are coming to pass immediately. But again, let me know if you want me to read this book to you 3 times out this week. If not, I'm still going to do it at least once or twice. But I want to get through this book because I need you to know. I want to get a record for our children's children that they can go back to and realize what's on the book, what's on the pages, what's the laws that are currently on the books, what's the laws that's been enforced by this country, and what's the laws that can be still enforced if we don't get our acts together and stop just being all entertained and into these games and the stuff that means nothing. Okay. So again, I want to thank everybody. Get the book, The American Slave Code in Practice and in Theory by William Goodell. Get the book, please. Get the book. And I thank you all for tuning in. Remember this, real talk is about real talk, real issues, and real solutions. I am going to change the world. That's my ambition. I am going to change the world. And I am changing the world right now. Don't need money to change the world. Just need the hunger and the thought. And it's just do it. Okay? With that said, I want to thank you all for tuning in. I made 3 videos today. Check them all out. Because they're all of substance. And I thank you, Will, Sherry. What's up, Gant, old school? I thank you, Sherry, and Natalia, and Sean. We gotta get together. Now, you guys know I'm a national farm instructor. Not just national, I'm worldwide. I can go anywhere in the world and teach firearms. Legally. Okay? So, hit me up, JuanJohn29. @gmail.com. What's up, Greg? The whole crew, Jerome, Kathy, Duane. I just want to thank you guys for taking time out your busy day to even listen to me. I'm going to keep it real. I'm going to keep it honest. And you never know what I'm going to say because, again, I'm a lamp. Lamp is what? 20 years law enforcement, 20 years of activist, 20 years of minister, and 20 years of police officer. So I see things differently. I appreciate you. Want nothing but the best for you. And remember this. It is not how much you know. It's how much you care. I'm out. Peace.